morning. It's Tuesday, the 7th of February, 2017. Well, before I came up to chat to you today, I had, as always, the news on the BBC News 24 channel. The lovely, very posh Victoria Derbyshire was on. And then, at about 9:30, it cut. It was 9:30 or 9 o'clock, one of the two. It cut to the sports news, which usually at that point I flick straight over. There's nothing of it's so boring sports news. It really is. And let's talk about the football. And then they have the cricket scores, which no one can understand unless you're into cricket. You know, 255 bowls for 10 not out. What does that mean? What does that mean? I mean, at least with football, it's clear who's winning. You know, 1-0 means the person who scored one is winning. Cricket, not a clue. Not a clue what's going on there. Excuse me, a little frog in the throat this morning. But no, that's not Iwona. Before I switched over, suddenly he appeared. And look at this. Look how the standards continue to slip at the BBC. Look at this. Where's the shirt and tie? So he's just walked onto the set with something that is clearly picked up from Sports Direct or JD Sports. Where is the shirt and tie? It's disgusting. You know, the next thing they'd be wandering in and out like those people that go shopping in their pyjamas. This is just as bad. Where's the shirt and tie? Awful. I mean, for God's sake, we never had this when Moira Stewart or Richard Baker or Angela Rippon were reading the news. Bring back the old school. That's what I say. How can you go on television, on BBC? The standards are falling before your very eyes. They really are. No shirt and tie. It's disgusting. It really is. Look at the effort that I make to see you every morning. OK, I know it wasn't like this in the early days, you know, when we had just one or two viewers. But now with the millions of people joining us almost every day for United Kingdom Talk, I do try and make an effort. I did go the tie route at one point, but I wasn't sure about it, to be honest. Sometimes I'll wear a tie, sometimes not. Today not, as you may can, as you can definitely see there. All right, now, I don't know what's going on here, dear. Look, a water bill has arrived. Let me just, don't want to reveal my address to you, because you'll only come round, won't you? Start taking photographs. Oh, we had a lovely day out today. We went to see Chris Reardon's house. Yes, we don't want any of that here, dear. Besides, I don't know how you're going to dress. I mean, if you turn up like the bloke who was just reading the sports on BBC News 24, dear, what would the neighbours say? Look at this. A water bill for 6 months. £128 for flushing the bog. £128 for water, dear. God's sake, man. You know what I did before I first had a water meter? That sounds a lot. But believe me, if I was on water rates, that would be about £350 now. Honestly. Honestly. But still, £128. That's about £20 a month. £5 a week. Almost £1 a day for flushing the toilet. I'm going to go somewhere else. Yes, I'm going to dig a hole round the back of my garden fence and start using that. We can't afford to keep dishing out money like this. Either that, I know what I could do. I could use my water butt water, couldn't I? Well, I did actually. I did do that once. Ronnie went mad. He thought it was disgusting. I used to have two buckets. I've got two large water butts in the garden. And I had buckets in front of me and I'd fill them up with water. And whenever I use a toilet, I'd get a bucket and walk it through the kitchen and then just plunge it down the toilet. Save money on the water. The only thing is, I'm not very careful carrying the buckets. There's always been drips of water all over the place, you know. And it's bad enough with a cat mucking up the floor. Oh, yes, another mess to clean up this morning. As I got up, I opened the kitchen door. Oh, the smell, dear. Fortunately, she is now going on the newspaper. If you are a new viewer to the show, let me tell you, I have a lovely cat. Her name is Katie. When my mother died, I took her on. She's now 18 years old, about 18 years old. But she has now started. She doesn't use the litter tray anymore. The litter tray is for weeing, according to her. You know, that's only for weeing. And the kitchen floor is for number twos. You know, but I've now covered almost the whole half of the kitchen floor and she now goes on the newspaper. So not too bad. Not so bad now. Before, a couple of weeks ago, before I started covering the kitchen in paper, she'd go on the floor, and that was bad enough. And there was one particular day where she'd gone and walked in it and round, and likes to walk round in circles a lot. Round and round and round. And she'd gone in it like that. I was actually talking to someone last night, yesterday daytime, on the way to a swimming pool. There's a bloke who comes out, and he's got four cats. And I was telling him, he said, oh, no, no, no. He said, what quality of life has she got now? You know, does she go out? I said, no, she never goes out. I said, I leave the door open. She don't want to go out. Her entire life is sitting in the kitchen, either asleep, when she looks happiest, to be honest, she looks asleep, sitting there, just staring blankly at the kitchen wall, or walking around in circles while eating and going to the toilet. That's it. She don't do anything else. He says she must be suffering. And I don't know. I don't think she is suffering. Not yet. If she was, that would be a different thing. I don't think she is yet. You know, she seems... Now and again, she'd come up and she has a little bit of a purr and a stroke. So, you know, we carry on going as long as we can. Maybe I could use the water butt water to clean the floor as well. Save even money. £128 for a bit of water. Blimey, what do they do with all that? I don't know. A lovely night last night at the karaoke. Once again, I've had three birthday cakes. Three! And this great big birthday cake came out. Chocolate with little buttons and those little, what are they called? Profita rolls. Dotted all around it with bits of chocolate in it. Ray Reynolds and Johnny Key came onto the stage with it. Here it is. There it is. That's Johnny Key there on the left. He often sends in quite a few of the news stories, which you'll hear later on in the show today. Ray Reynolds on the right there. And there's yours truly in the morning, looking in the middle there, looking very, very happy with my lovely chocolate cake. Mmm, we like cake. Isn't that lovely? And they sang happy birthday and more presents. I had chocolates brought to me. And this lovely little plant, look at this, from Kin. Kin is one of our top singers. He comes along to the karaoke. Now, it doesn't matter if you can sing or not. I've said this so many times before. If you can sing, fine. If you can't sing, fine. No problem. It's all about having a go. So Kin bought me that. That's Maureen's one there. There's Ray Reynolds' one from Christmas. And it's still going this time, Ray. I'm quite pleased about that. We're not very lucky with poinsettias, so a very, very nice night there indeed. Today, I'm going to Reading, which is a quiet little village in the English countryside. It's not really. It's a dump. Reading is an absolute dump. They've got this one-way system that goes around, and nothing can move. And this is all the time. It really is. And there's some really dodgy people walking through the town centre. You know the sort. Carrying cans of beer and that sort of thing. All dreadful, ghastly people, dear. Ghastly people. But they have a John Lewis. I know, in Reading. You wouldn't expect it, would you? So me and my friend go in John Lewis. And, you know, we quickly move from the car to John Lewis to be off that street as rapidly as possible, dear. Awful people. And... and we sit there. Sometimes we might have something to eat and we rush from John Lewis, walking very fast, clutching our little bags into some sort of a pizza place or something like that. And then we sit at the window and we do ask the other people, the members of staff, to lock the doors while we're sitting there watching them outside, walking past and being horrible. Nasty people are out walking around in Reading. I'm sorry. Awful place. So that's what I'm doing today, because I'm getting my new iPhone SE. Yes, it's on its way. Now, is that going to make any difference to the show? I hope so, but maybe you won't see it. It's supposed to be faster. And once I've recorded, especially the hour-long shows, once that's been recorded, and they're all recorded, that's an iPhone. Right in front of me, it's not a camera, it's an iPhone there. All the recordings are done on the iPhone. The quality, I find, is far, far superior from any webcam or video camera. I bought a domestic video. I've never bought, like, a professional one, like thousands of pounds. I think it's a little bit much to spend on something like this. So maybe the picture will look better, but the speed-wise of what it saves the show I'm hoping we'll be a lot better like that. Good. Thank you very much again to Johnny Key for bringing in some news stories. Here's one here. Now, some of these are a little bit old because you bought these in a few weeks ago, but you may not have heard them. A Starbucks barista. Starbucks barista. Why are they called barista? Why not just called coffee makers? They have to have some poncy name, don't they? Barista. A Starbucks barista has been suspended after mocking a customer with a stammer by writing Richard on it. Oh, come on. That's not nice, is it, dear? Rude. Richard Proctor said he was left humiliated by the incident. After he struggled to tell the employee his name due to the speech impediment while buying a coffee. Oh, it's not very nice, that is it? That really isn't very nice at all. The businessman complained to Starbucks, which has a policy of writing customers' names on cups so that they get the correct orders on the company's via the company's Facebook page. I've never really liked that, really. What's your name, please? Why do you want to know my name? You know, and they write it on the Starbucks cup. The treatment I received from one of the Starbucks staff this morning was extremely offensive and humiliating, he wrote. Would this be acceptable to a person with more obvious disabilities? I highly doubt it. Now, I don't know. We might not know the whole story there. Maybe there was a little bit of banter going backwards and forwards. And the coffee maker, I'm not going to call him a barrister. That's a stupid name, dear. But what do you do? A barrister. I thought a barrister was someone that worked in the courts, didn't you? Or do you say it differently? Barrister. Barista. I bet there's like an accent on the A or the R somewhere. But yeah, a little bit too much, that one, isn't it? You know, we do like to have a little bit of a joke, usually at my expense. You know, if someone, I've got to say, if I went into Starbucks and they said, and the cup come back with gay boy Chris, I'd be all right with that. I'd be all right with that. But no doubt, someone politically correct was, oh, that's incorrect. It should say LGBT, Chris. Oh, please, LGBT. What is all this crap, dear? Gay. Just say gay. That's it. You know, I'm running out of letters and words, dear. When we are born, I don't know, most people probably don't know this, but when we are born, we are only given so many words to say. I can't remember, mine's in the millions at some point. And at one point, we will run out. And if people keep coming up with this crap, you are helping us to run out of words to say, dear. LGBT, do me a favour, dear. But everyone has to be, everyone has to be included. We are included, gay, that's it. Gay, girl, boy, whatever, gay. Half, you know, whatever. God's sake. Now, here's a lovely little story, and I kept meaning to tell you this. I love this. I love this little story, and it's from a few weeks ago. What a cute salute from a little recruit. He had been taken to Windsor Castle as a birthday treat and was dressed in his mini guardsman's outfit, especially for the occasion. Look at this. As 4-year-old Marshall Scott watched changing the guard, he instinctively saluted the 4 soldiers taking part. But then, little Marshall, who dreams of one day becoming a Royal Guardsman, oh yes, received a surprise before his a surprise beyond his wildest dreams. Oh, there's a couple of surprises I'd like. There really is. I will not reveal them to you on this programme. For as the cold scream guardsmen dressed in their grey winter uniforms strode off at the end of the ceremony towards their lodgings, one turned around. Lance Corporal Paul Eden marched up to Marshall, who was still busy saluting, halted and ordered the youngster to stand next to him. I love this. To the delight of onlookers, the guardsman then posed for pictures with an amazed Marshall who's wearing his red guards. Oh, do you know it's bringing tears to my eyes, that? It's such a lovely story. Who was wearing his red guardsman uniform, complete with mini bearskins hat, bless his heart. Marshall's mother from Slough, Berkshire. Oh, there's another dump. Oh, my God. I mean, Bracknell is like an oasis. It really is. Where I live, Bracknell, it's like an oasis between Slough and Reading. Both complete and utter dumps. They really are awful places. And Bracknell is like a little oasis in between the two. It really is. Really is. I think I think the whole of Bracknell should become a gated community. I'm liking the sound of that. Where people need special little cards and things that go, and the gate opens and you enter Bracknell. Yes, you probably wouldn't be allowed here. You know, I'm looking at you this morning. I'm thinking you're more of a Reading person. Or maybe even Slough, I don't know. I don't think you're a Bracknell person, I really don't. It goes on to say, I want to say thank you to all of them, said his mum. Marshall is very patriotic and says the Queen is lovely and beautiful. Let's have a look at that picture again. What a nice thing for that man to do. The guardsman there, look. Isn't that lovely? And talking of the Queen being patriotic, did you see her yesterday? Was it her, not Ruby, her, was it the Sapphire? Oh, gosh. It was a very, 65 years. The Queen's 65 years on the throne. The longest ever person to be head of the country. How fantastic is that? Good on you, ma'am. I hear that the Queen is a regular viewer to this programme. She really is. Now, let's have a look at some messages from yesterday's show, boys and girls. Mari says, bringing on back the good times. Now, the song I mentioned yesterday, did you look it up yet? You must. Type it into YouTube when you finish watching this. Bringing on back the good times. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's a 1960s song. Type it into YouTube and have a listen. I know you're going to like that. Mari says they don't write them like that anymore. Loved listening to this one again. So have a listen to that. Bringing on back the good times. Type it into YouTube, okay? Simon Keane says, oh, thank you, Simon and Mary, for my record tray. It's like a tray made in like a record. Thank you for that yesterday. I meant to bring that up and show everyone today. I'll try and remember tomorrow. Simon says, thanks for the support for the miserable nonsense of humour people. You are correct. It is getting ridiculous. I'm so glad I'm not alone on this. Oh, there's hundreds of them, Simon. Fortunately, not many of them turn up at my karaoke nights. They come once and realise that they don't fit in. Bye-bye. Bye. If you've got a sense of humour, please pop along to the karaoke and quiz nights. If not, don't bother, dear. We don't want to be sitting there looking at miserable bastard faces all night long of people that don't laugh at anything. Simon also says, it's funny you mentioned casualty. I was in AA and E. Oh, you mean A and E. You put two A's there. Simon, Simon, I'm looking at your little comment, dear. It's not very good punctuation on there, dear. There's no capital letters, no sentences, dear. I think we're going to have to ask you to start using a spell checker, lovey. I really do, lovey. It says, I was in A&E at... I'll translate for you, everyone. I was in A&E at 11 o'clock yesterday morning, taken in with excruciating pain in my liver area. Oh, my word. Well, I'm not surprised with the amount you drink, dear. Knocking them back left, right and centre. He turned up the other Monday at the karaoke on Monday night at the Central Station. Yes. He's been on antibiotics since Friday for liver infection. And yesterday I had 3 pints of Guinness. And that's what... You don't learn, do you? You don't learn. You've been on antibiotics on Friday and you went drinking on Sunday. I mean, I'm sorry, Simon. How stupid can you be? You don't drink for 2 weeks. That's what's causing the problem. Oh, my word. It's like, you know, people who have got cancer or had heart disease and continue to smoke. I know a few of those. And you know who you are. You watch this programme. Why do you do it? Madness. Madness, Simon. Come on. You cannot drink while you're on antibiotics. And even then, you know, I'd come off that for a month, mate, until you're all sorted. He had 3 pints of Guinness, and that's what's caused the pain today. See? I'm not supposed to drink alcohol on these antibiotics, but I thought it would be okay as Guinness has iron in it. Oh, come on, Simon. Knock the drink on the head. I could be a doctor, couldn't I? Would you like me to come and examine you? You know, get my rubber glove on. Start peering into your little holes. Would you like me to do that, lovey? Eh? Would you like a Chris Reardon exam? It's very colourful behind here. I can see it in front of me. Isn't that lovely? Beautiful flowers. We must have more flowers in the studio. Simon says, I've got painkillers and antibiotics. I've just got a rest. Drink water. No alcohol for 3 weeks. There you go. So why did you drink it? That's okay, I can handle that. Thank you, Chris. I can still have a fun night out with blackcurrant and soda water. Oh, yes, blackcurrant and soda water. Thank you. Hello to Jackie Evans. She sends a little birthday message. Again, thank you for your many, many, many birthday messages, boys and girls. I really do appreciate them. So many, so many. I haven't got through them all yet. So thank you very much for those, okay? One more little story before we do today's birthdays. Is anywhere, and this is in the Daily Mail this morning, is anywhere safe from the lycra louts? Now, we've seen these. In fact, I was talking about this on the at the karaoke last night. You know, fat people, overweight people like myself, overweight. Yes, I am. You can't see it under this shirt. I wish people would stop saying, oh, you're not overweight, Chris. You haven't seen me naked. Do you want to? I'll give you another website that I'll do special little shows on for that. £1.50 a minute. I am fat. And it makes me laugh how these fat people put great big things. They squeeze them. I don't have any problem with how people look. Honestly, I don't care how big you are. But for Christ's sake, why are you wearing lycra and Speedos in the swimming pool? Do you realise what you look like? There's some very big people who squeeze into the tiniest of clothes because they think it looks sexy. It does not. Even I've stopped wearing my very tight white underpants and looking at myself in the mirror because it made me feel physically sick. It made me feel physically sick. Anyway, it says, forget road clogging. Chelsea mums on the school running their 4x4s. Oh, have you seen that lot? Oh, they just stop in the middle. I've got to get my kids. Got to get my kids. Get out of the way. I've got to get my kids. Like the ones with the prams. I've got a buggy. I've got a buggy. Get out of my way. Got buggy. Gives you no rights over anyone, darling. The only people I give way to are people in wheelchairs. Proper disabled people. Not mums that get out of their cars whatever, because they're too lazy to get to park further back. Never mind fist-shaking, foul-mouthed road ragers. Don't fret about the old lady in a Skoda you inevitably get stuck behind. There's a force on the road far worse than all of those, and you know who they are, and more likely to send your blood pressure soaring, the smug cyclist. Now, before I read you this, you need to know that I am also a cyclist, and I stop at red lights. I do not mow people down on the path. I get there, I get near to them. If we're on a cycle, shared cycle pathway, there's a lot of those in Bracknell, I give them a little ting. And they move over and I move over and that's it. But unfortunately, the worst ones are the cyclists in London. I mean, why more of them? And they come on the paper today, come in the paper. Oh, cyclist has been killed by lorry turning left. Yeah. But what was the cyclist doing coming down the inside of the lorry? And to be fair, it's not just cyclists. It's those blooming, what's the name of those? Something to do with a kangaroo. Kangaroo, you know, the Deliveroo. The Deliveroo people are also doing it now on their mopeds. They're coming down the inside lane. So when I say the inside lane, I mean you're on the inside lane and that tiny little bit of road that's between you and the pavement. They're coming down there now. I've had my mirror knocked and you can't catch them once they've gone. The lycra clad darters between the cars, these self-side saints in the saddle, are clogging up our roads with self-satisfaction. I'd rather take my chances with the carbon emissions from cars than with the moral emissions that emanate from these puffed up two-wheeled eco-warriors. The fact is, they're polluting our towns and cities with clouds of self-righteousness, and you've seen them there all the time. It is horrendous, absolutely horrendous. And there's a growing common sense among bikers is that cyclists should rule the road. Their arrogant attitude, and it is arrogant, now, I've never had a row with them, but I've seen it going on. I've seen it. One of the funniest things I saw just a few things ago, so a few weeks ago, this cyclist was trying to squeeze between two cars, right? But then the car next to me on the right, the car in front of him, moved forward. So he moved forward as well and went over his foot. Good, good, good. I mean, they just do not stick to the rules. Have you seen them? Oh, it's dreadful. Anyway, so there's a growing sense among cyclists, as I say, that bikes should rule the world. This is in part down to their belief that their chosen method of transport isn't about them getting from A to B, but also about saving the planet, which you can understand. But that you've got to stick to the rules. They don't. They jump the red lights. Not just as they go red, but, you know, seconds after they've gone red. Again, to be fair, there's a lot of motorists that are doing this as well. They are jumping the red lights 2, 3, 4, 5 seconds after they've actually gone red. So very bad on the cyclists. It's just some of the cyclists. But I mean, please come on. Stop wearing the lycra if you're fat like me. And do not come to the swimming pool in tight Speedos if you're fat like me. Because me and my mate will just sit there and we will take the piss out of you. We will take the piss. We will. Let's do today's birthdays, gang. And happy birthday today to... Here they come. Come on, where are... is that a real person? Is that a real person, Joe Bloggs? I don't think it is it? Let's have a look. There's no photo on there, so I'm assuming that's not a real person. Oh, it might be. Joe Bloggs. Well, it might be. Why is there no... Why have you not got a profile picture there, Joe Bloggs? I don't understand that. No. I don't think you're a real person. Unfollowing. There we go. Let's get a rat. I should take that one back. There's no birthday today for Joe Bloggs. I don't believe there's a Joe Bloggs birthday, OK? I don't believe that person exists. Happy birthday today to Steve Brewer, 49 years old today. Happy birthday, Steve. To Madzlan... happy birthday to Madzlan today. To Laura Rickner. Hello, little Laura. You beautiful lady. Oh, she used to come and sing at my karaoke. Happy birthday, Laura. Happy birthday to Billy Draper, 33 years old today. To John Tobias. To Karmel Ridgely, who I went to school with. No, not secondary. Primary school. Happy birthday, Carmel. 55 today, aren't you? A little bit ahead of me. Happy birthday to Christian Taylor. And to Rose Marie Kane. Oh, what a lovely name. Happy birthday to you all, gang. Here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Enjoy your Tuesdays, boys and girls. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I had a little bit of fun today. I'll see you again on the next show. Bye-bye now.